Hello everyone, thank you for joining. So this webinar is conducted by DFI in partnership with Altair Engineering. We are focusing on the simulation techniques and methods and how they help us improve the design of a drone in terms of from other alternative prototyping and design and development methods. Altair is a company that exclusively focuses on simulation practices across multiple industries, including automobiles and aviation, aerospace, and drones is also something that they're now focusing on. And in this webinar, we'll largely learn about the kind of advantages that simulation techniques provide to a drone developer and how exactly Altair's products add the value proposition to one's design and development lifecycle. So that's the basic introduction. Thank you for joining. Vasanta from Altair will take up the next part of introductions about the technicalities that we'll be speaking about. Over to you, Vasanta.
Yeah, thanks, Deep. One logistic thing, Deep, question answer we'll have in the end, right?
Up to you.
Yeah, I think it is better we have, and people who any questions, they can chat put that in the chat window, and then we can answer them in the end.
Sure.
Yeah, thanks. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
I think this something is this is also okay. Okay. Thank you. Good afternoon. Thanks for joining. I'm Vasant. Today's agenda is a brief introduction about Altair and also about the simulation, why simulation is required, what is the advantages of simulation-driven design, how companies can make use of simulation-driven design in their entire product design and development cycle. I'll be covering the introductory part, and then followed by me, Manoj KV, who will talk about model-based development approach to drone design. And again, I'll come back on to touch upon the structural aspects. Soundarya will cover electronic system design part, and Srinivas Tangdu will cover IoT and digital twin. So in the end, we'll summarize, and then we can take up the question and answer. Trust my voice is clear, Deep.
Yes, very much.
Yeah. Thank you. Coming to a brief introduction about Altair, our vision is to transform enterprise decision-making by leveraging the convergence of simulation, high-performance computing, and artificial intelligence. We believe that the present day, in future, already we have started seeing the products are multidisciplinary in nature. We have mechanical, electronics, electrical, all combined together, which are driving the designs. So Altair has got a solution to cater to this smart product development needs. We are established in 1985, headquartered in Troy, Michigan, with 3,000 plus engineers, scientists, and creative thinkers. We have 11,000 customers globally. 25 offices in, 86 offices in 25 countries. We clocked close to, we are NASDAQ listed company, close to 470 million in FY20. We have 150 plus products, technologies, along with our partner products. So our solution portfolio, technology portfolio is design modeling and visualization. So this is a portfolio. This portfolio is for preparing the model for simulation and visualizing the results. And then we have a multi-physics platform, which caters to various physical attributes of the product, which people design. And then, for example, thermal, structural part, flow part, electrical, electronics. So you name any physics, we have suite of software which caters to that. Followed by the order of the day is anything on artificial intelligence and data analytics, which seamlessly we have a solution to take the data seamlessly from the 1D modeling throughout the design product design cycle, as well as use the past data for improving the product, and then connected. We have connected products everywhere you see that, and a solution for Internet of Things, and all these connected things are connected. High performance products are require high performance cloud and computing. We cater to those needs. Also, along with for niche simulations, Alter Partner Alliance programs. Around 11,000 customers worldwide across the industry verticals. Throughout the geography and close to around 3,000 plus customers in India. Why Alter? We not only have best-in-class software for data analytics and AI, as well as simulation, we have a global domain and simulation expertise where people across the globe, we speak to each other on the, what is the work being done, and then exchange the ideas and cross-pollinate across the domains on the projects. We not only develop and then sell the software, we demonstrate the technology, as well as we handhold the customers and then do the technology transfer in how you best use of these simulation technologies. Of course, we are leaders in optimization and then HPC technology. Our product suite is open architecture. That means the products or tools can talk to our competitor product as well. And we have a patented licensing model. This is about Alter. So as I already told you, a global evolution is towards smart, connected products with strong user experience. And then these connected products with multi-physics in nature will need technologies to explore the ideas, even at the concept stage itself, and optimize the ideas. And that calls for HPC and cloud. To meet these, we have solutions in terms of data analytics, as well as a simulation stack, catering to various physics and optimization. 1D modeling and 3D modeling, and of course, connected IoT stack, and then process optimization and process improvement through a digital twin or condition monitoring. So the trends in drones or UAVs, of course, this is an Indian industry around a decade old. Drones are becoming more automated in terms of a semi-automated or fully autonomous, and this calls for they are to be connected V2X communication with vehicle to vehicle, drone to drone, or drone to base station, drone to other satellite, etc. And then since this calls for taking more payload, they have to be very light in design. People are working with special materials to make them light, and then with the improved manufacturing process. And then drones or UAVs are as a miniature version of the actual aircraft. So you have everything like aircraft, but they, for some applications, they want very, very small in nature. So miniaturization is happening. And then different types of propulsion, a battery or a solar. Of course, AI, ML, and IoT is also driving here with the need for highly performing motors, efficient motors, and people are also talking about using drones as for urban air mobility. So all these aspects are the trends in the future of drones require designs right from the beginning to be optimized, analyzed, and then informed decisions be taken with very less time to market and then with less cost. These are the a survey, few trends or few needs which are driving the simulation businesses towards simulation driving design. Few of them are shortened development cycles, schedules, pressure to differentiate among products in terms of quality, reliability, et cetera. And then need for a greater innovation project, products, and then at low costs. So these are some of the things pressures, business pressures, which are driving people or companies to move towards or adopting simulation-driven design as a methodology in their product lifecycle. Like any other system nowadays, the drones are also complex, and those complex integrated systems call for many attributes from expected out of them. I listed them, some of them here, maybe a safety aspect. They need to carry more payload, higher range and more power to carry to the range. And they have to be stable. They have to have stable and control system. Of course, a lightweight in structure, and they have to be have a communication system which connect with the base station or any other devices as such for their control or stability purpose. So what is the role of such simulation in such complicated highly integrated systems? Are right from the beginning concept or ideation stage itself, you can use the simulation as a tool to iterate our many ideas, many design ideas, right? And innumerable number of times concepts can be evaluated and optimized from as well as equation to a 3D model, or it could also be used as a verification or validation tools for failure mode analysis, or if you want to improve the design, etc. Manufacturing feasibility can also be incorporated while doing the concept design itself, or these tools can be used for operations or in service, or if something is you already designed and is working and it has failed, then you can do the failure investigation through these tools. So simulation plays a major role in product design and development cycle. So this the top one illustrates what is traditional design process, wherein which you develop a concept, you have an idea of a product, you develop different concepts, and then do a detailed design and fit, and then validation or do a prototype, test it, and then if it passes, fine. If it not intent function, then you have to go back and redevelop the concepts and then rework it. So this is it takes more time, and then it's costly as such. But the beauty of simulation driven design process is, as I already told you, you can at the concept stage itself, you can optimize the design for including the manufacturing feasibility and all other constraints, compare the concepts, and then take it to next step as detailed design, so that a matured concept goes to the detailed design, and then you can prove the concepts through test with very minimal testing. So what does mean is that you can save money as well as the time to market will be reduced. This is how the simulation-driven design has evolved. Way back in 70s or 80s, it was mainly used as a validation tool or verification tool, mainly in the aero industry for a certification purpose. And then once the computer have become high performing computers, at least cost, hence the cost has coming down for the computing power in 90s and 2000, it has picked up. And then the simulation driven design is in the product design and development cycle across domains, and as well as various companies have started getting the benefit of them and started using them or put them in term as a part of their product design and development cycle. But the trend now and the future will be a data-driven design. Of course, it could be in terms of using the data right from a smaller subset to till you take it to the 3D level seamlessly, or if you already have a data about the past failures, past testing, past validation to validation or simulation data that could be used, and algorithms can be built to analyze the various scenario for the future products. So this is a way forward. I think you could see that expert systems or machine learning algorithms to predict design behavior in 30s or 35 or in next 10 to 15 years. So this is an important survey where companies across the globe and across the domains have been chosen to answer, where they are categorized into top 20. They call them as a multi-physics leaders. You extensively use multi-physics simulation in their product design and development cycle, and rest 80% as followers. So you could clearly see the people who have used the multi-physics platform, they have met all their performance targets in terms of more than by 20% in terms of quality, cost, revenue metrics, and launch target, as well as the important thing is the development time is cut by almost half that of the multi-physics followers. So this clearly shows the leaders, the people who adopt the multi-physics simulation softwares or platforms, are the leaders who meet the product design and development targets. So with this, I just want to, this is how the flow will happen for the rest of the session. So essentially, the way we have planned is a traditional V cycle of product design and development in terms of concept. On your left side, you see the digital or a simulation. And then on towards the right, you have a physical thing. So Manoj KV will cover the model-based systems, followed by I'll come again to cover upon the structural aspects. And then Soundarya will cover the FICO and WinProps or EM design, and then PCB design, and followed by Srinivas Tangdu on IoT and digital twin. Over to Manoj.
Thank you, Vasanta. Let me.
I'll stop share.
Yeah. Yes, please. Can you confirm once you are able to see?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Great. So, good afternoon, everyone. So, as Vasanta was mentioning about, you know, the aspects of drone development and how simulation-driven design or the data-driven design can really help in reducing the time to market for such drones. So if you really look at the traditional V cycle, as you know, it starts with the requirements, a system modeling, where we really look at the concept design of the entire drones, and then we move on to a detailed design followed by you know, test and validation of each components. It could be batteries, motors, and all the major key components available in the drone. And further to that, you know, we could look at the hardware in loop, where we really look at you know, testing our microcontrollers and so on. So in the next 10 minutes or so, we are really going to talk about model-based development. And typically, when we look at a model-based development, you know, we fall into three major categories. That is, one is on the virtual validation and concept design phase, where multiple physics that are involved in drones can be brought together, and complex systems of system simulations can be understood, validated, and really an upfront, you know, simulation-driven design can be achieved. On the other side of the V curve, we really see an embedded system development to streamline our embedded design process. And also along with that comes real-time hardware in looping and deployment to a microcontrollers and so on. And the third aspect to this model-based development is the all-in-one math scripting. Basically, the analytical equations that you have for drones can be pretty much modeled. And this applies on both the sides of the V cycle. So we could use it for testing automations or understanding the any early behavior of the drones and so on. So to put it in another format, so all these three areas or three containers of model-based development can be understood in a little more detail as well. So the first container is on the scripting aspects, which is more on the mathematical scripting. And in terms of this mathematical scripting, there are extensive libraries available where we could look at signal processing, differential equations, controls, dynamics, numerical optimization, and so on and so forth. And all the mathematics available can be pretty much scripted. And port of solutions or software solutions also enable, as an integrated development environment. So although our core base is the open matrix, which is pretty much similar to, follows a global syntax compatible for any other math tool. But we also have an environment inside our solution, where you can write your scripts in Python, R, TCL, and in real time of that script, you can exchange the information and data between all these multiple languages. So it's truly an integrated environment where you can play around with multiple things. And of course, there are 2D and 3D plotting and visualization capabilities that can be enhanced out of this particular solution, that is Altair Compose. So on the other aspect where we are looking at a system modeling side is to really look at the entire modeling in terms of 0D to 3D. So what we really mean is from a basic script to connecting multiple blocks with having no code blocks and developing an entire system, either based out of signal based or using some kind of physical entities, or also co-simulating where we can really co-simulate with three-dimensional software solutions. These all different 0D, 1D, and 3D fall into the modeling semantics for these kind of model-based solutions. So here, the advantage of this, especially for an applications like drone, is it is very much a multi-physics environment. Starting from batteries, motors, which fall into the purview of electrical and electronics, microcontrollers, to the propellers, which really fall into the domain of mechanics. So there is this advantage here that we can do these kind of multi-physics simulations and integrate to really understand the behavior of the system. So you might have also heard of Modelica, which is one of the physical based physical block based methodology. It has multiple entities for physical modeling. It could be as simple as a resistor, inductor, or a gearbox, pump, springs, machines, and dampers, and so on. So all of these different aspects can be modeled. The other side of the V curve, which is on the embedded generation or embedded code generation, is mostly on the deployment of generating of code, ANSI C code that can be deployed to microcontrollers, and performing all sorts of software in loop or processor in loop or hardware in loop systems, along with it has its own set of libraries for eDrives and digital power. So this is kind of portfolio that caters to every step of your product development process. So on that note, let me quickly talk about one of the workflows that we have in here. And so if you really look at the workflow in terms of modeling and simulating a quadcopter, so we have Inspire, where we can build pretty much a geometry to really understand the fit and the form of the quadcopter that is built. And of course, this information can be then realized into Activate, which is again our model-based solution, where we can really understand the functionality of the entire quadcopter as well. So this functional model can then also be realized into an Unreal Engine based out of an RT simulator, just to understand the and visualize the controls that have been built and how the functional model is behaving. So let me dig in a little more deep into what the functional model is. So drone per se can be treated as a plant, which is nothing but all sorts of designs in terms of motors and batteries. And then there is a controller, which really controls the attitude as well as the position in terms of angles and XYZ and so on, that can really help. So if you really look at the plant model per se, there are two approaches. One, we could develop a fully signal-based model based out of math equations, but not really developing code, but just connecting multiple blocks. The other approach would be a mixed approach where you connect, you know, signals as well as the physical entities, like for instance, you know, mass of the body or so on and so forth can be connected. So I just have a short video that really talks about how we have achieved this. So this is the Inspire environment where we have tried to understand the inertial parameters. And here we are in the Activate environment where we are trying to initialize some of the parameters like the mass of the body, the inertial parameters that we have obtained from the Inspire model. And here we have the full system model of the drone, which starts with, let's say, entire body, where we have the mass of the body being assigned correctly and all the inertial parameters. And the motor is then connected to this body, and motor has this electromagnetic and the mechanical system drives. So both of these connected with some of the physical blocks here, you can see like inertia and so on. So this is further connected to battery, which is again trying to identify the state of the charge of the system, and a control board really to make sure that things are in control. And you know, we have these PID controls to take care of the entire plant mechanism. So as you can see, we can quickly achieve the kind of positions in terms of, let's say, Z, the reference as well as the actual. We can understand in my time domain how the results are varying. Same applies for SOC, and any other parameter can be quickly achieved. So you see a depletion from 80 to almost 79.4% in terms of the battery behavior. So once this has been performed, once we have a functional model ready, we can export it as an FMU and pretty much run them in a Unreal Engine. So for instance, here we have a RT simulator based out of Unreal Engine, and we can really visualize and understand how the, you know, our control systems have been worked out and how the model is as well. So truly understanding the whole scenario where we can see, build up a scenario and then try to look at the behavior of our drone systems. So, but that's all that we've done now is pretty much modeled on a very system level, in a sense that we have all the different batteries, motors, everything connected together and trying to build a system. But if we were to really look at, let's say, some of the key critical components like batteries, we could also look at modeling them in further detail. So for instance, if we were looking at battery, we can pretty much do a purpose-driven fidelity. So we could start with, let's say, an equivalent circuit model, basic RC parameters that drive the battery. And we can enhance its fidelity by improving with some kind of diffusion voltages. Or we can look at you know, our Modelica libraries, with which we can reuse our you know, battery models. We also have a partner alliance with Sendyne, which is our which is based out of actually an electrochemistry or electrochemical based model, and we can pretty much reuse this as well if you are looking at a electrochemical based battery modeling. So there are various such degrees and fidelity with which we can model such kind of parameters. So just to illustrate an example, let's say if we are looking at a series and parallel combination of cells, and each cell being modeled as you know, with respect to voltage and its state of charge, we can pretty much do such kind of things and couple them as an electrical circuit in as well series as well as in parallel the way we want it. And once we are able to achieve this, we can look at a balancing of the cells as well by creating a basic electrical circuit to really understand how the cell balancing is happening. And also we can check out the thermal module as well. So once all the cells are there, how the behavior of the you know, battery pack in terms of thermal can be also done using our Modelica thermal libraries that you can see here. So all these different facilities along with the battery management systems can be pretty much achieved. The same thing applies for motors as well. We can write these model based, we can develop these kind of model based systems for different fidelities, starting with the basic signal based modeling using our basic Park equation and so on. Or if we have the torque versus speed characteristics and we have the efficiency map, we can look at a basic reduced order model and develop our motors. We have a multiple libraries available in Modelica for performing machines or motors per se. And if we are really looking at co-simulation, which means that this 1D platform of Activate can be combined or co-simulated with a three-dimensional entity or three-dimensional solution like Flux, which is our 3D solver for motors. So we can actually co-simulate them and make sure that the Flux runs behind the scenes, leading to a high accuracy because we are really running a three-dimensional solver here in behind the scenes. In terms of system design is one side, but on the terms of embedded systems as well, we can pretty much streamline and build these kind of system designs in terms of embedded. So there is embed, which is a unified environment where we can simulate these motors and power controllers. And we have the auto generation of code for a large amount of microcontrollers. So it starts from, just to name a few, STMicro, TI, Raspberry, Arduino, and so on. And these 12,000 plus controllers and their peripherals can easily be can be generated and deployed. And this is pretty efficient and easy to use. So the other aspects is the hardware in the loop that I was mentioning in the early slides. So typically when we look at hardware in loop, we use the PC as a console and we look forward to change various parameters or add disturbances and really look at how my microcontrollers is behaving. And that can be pretty much done using embed to understand the behavior of the control systems and the model itself. So this, as I was mentioning, automatic code generation minimizes these kind of requirements and really reduces development time to a very significant effect. So we've had multiple success stories and case stories around this, but I would just like to mention one that is on the Kappa Electronics, where we've developed a robust motor controls for drone applications. Where embed was used for a high-speed simulation of motor, and we used novel sensorless FOC methods to, develop these kind of motor controls as mechanisms. So just to summarize on the entire holistic systems simulations or model-based simulations for drones, to start with an electronic circuit, which is based out of SPICE to model the electronics behavior of the drones. Two motors, as you can see here, the Flux model where you can co-simulate. On the other side, the dynamics of the drones to want to really understand the behavior in terms of its motion. And on the other side, controllers to really virtually or in real time understand the behavior of control systems. So the entire such portfolio of various physics can be modeled at various fidelities and can be integrated as well. So these kind of work along a unified platform, starting from the 0D, 1D, and 3D, can be pretty much performed. And also, we can generate these kind of embedded codes for onboarding such kind of flight computers. So that's it from my side. I would like Vasant to talk a bit more on the structural aspects and focus on how we can build structural analysis over drones.
Thanks, Manoj.
Yeah, let me stop sharing. Thank you.
Thanks, Manoj. Truly, MBAC allows the evaluation of various vehicle systems to determine which best meets the various mission requirements. Please let me share my screen. Can somebody confirm if you can see the screen?
Yes, we can see something.
Yeah, thanks, Manoj. Yeah. So essentially, we'll look into the structural design challenges. Let me close this. I don't know. Okay, you can see the entire screen, right? Is there any mask? Okay, sorry. So essentially, various structural challenges can be addressed through various simulation tools or simulation methodologies, like multi-body dynamics or kinematics can be handled to design the kinematics aspects of mechanisms, or multi-body dynamics to estimate the forces and movements for further analysis. To get the forces and movements for structural design, or CFT or thermal analysis, CFT for external air flow to decide the external area and the shape of the objects, or thermal if you have a battery or any other thermal systems to find out the thermal aspects or thermal attributes of the system can be evaluated through CFT, and then to get the load from these and then do the structural analysis to find out their durability. And then combining all these things and then do the multi-physics simulations. If you want to combine all the various attributes to do the multi-physics simulation and optimize. Coming to if you want external objects or external scenarios to be simulated, like a bird impact or somebody standing on the wing or some tool is banged on the wing, or if there is a crash landing. So all those aspects can also be simulated. And then considering all these structural aspects, you can optimize the design, essentially. And then explore the various design and find out the manufacturing feasibility of the design. So these are the various challenges, design challenges that you can address through simulation. I just taken one example where if you want to clean sheet design, if you go here, just let me take the cursor. So you want to design a drone, a simple concept. So you know the art points here, 1, 2, 3, fair. Here you mount the rotors, then you apply the loads and get the optimized structure. A topology optimization could be done. And nowadays the manufacturing has so improved, you can even 3D print earlier rather than using the reduction or subtractive way of manufacturing. You can use the additive manufacturing to get any shape you want from the material. And then this gives the present baseline stress distribution and displacement. So by adopting these tools, we call that as upfront simulation tools or simulation revision tools. Designers could also use to generate and simulate, compare the designs early in the design cycle, evolve the best aspect considering the manufacturing aspect as well, and then detailed simulation can be done. Coming to computational fluid dynamics aspect, the drones taken through different environment. It could be internal inside the factory, or if it is outside, it is subjected to winds, subjected to any other altitudes, very high altitudes, and then all these aspects will induce the flow loads on the structure. And then to lift off or carry the load, you need the propellers. So you need to design the proper profile so that you can get the drag and the lift, a minimum drag and a maximum lift through number of propellers, propeller blade shapes. So all these aspects can be evaluated through CFD, or we call it as computational fluid dynamics. This is one example, aerodynamic optimization. As I said, external shape can be optimized, be it the nose or the fuselage or the wing. The flow over the outer body can be determined to reduce the drag and increase the lift. And then any turbulence which are happening or causing the unnecessary turbulence and then backflows, those aspects can be evaluated through optimization. We have a tool called virtual wind tunnel, which is essentially the you can put the design, your baseline designs, to the virtual simulation, and various parameters can be optimized for various conditions, or in this case, angle of attacks or various wind speeds. All those things can be simulated, and then design can be explored and optimized as well. So coming to the crash safety and impact aspect, for example, if a tool you want to simulate, if tool is dropped on the wing, or if there is a frontal crash or a crash landing, if you want to know what happens to the landing systems during crash landing, or if a drone hits on the head, a head impact, or a bird hits on the wing, what is the damage to the wing? What is the extent of damage can also be, and then you can optimize it for it, and then a forward leg drop landing. So all these various scenarios, you can assess the system performance. So this is one example where multi-body dynamics has been, to assess the forces for a quadrocopter, including the position, you can get the forces and the displacements for the system. This is one customer case study on a Eurocopter. So where you can predict where they used to predict the component load during various operation. For example, when these rotors or rotor blades rotate at different angle of attacks, at different mission profile, different altitudes, so they can predict the loads and then predict and get these loads for further structural analysis and do more what if studies to certify the design and then to improve the design for safety purpose. So this is a case study on multi-physics simulation. You, through CFD simulation, you predict the pressure over the surface of the aircraft and then interpolate them onto the structural model on a UAV for various angle of attacks on the wing and get this structural deformation and then the stresses across the cross section and then take that to optimization. So here optimization, you can do it on a part level, a metallic level, or on the structural level, or you can do that both composites also. So composite in terms of thickness optimization, the number of layers, the layup, or if you're up to, when you have an objective to reduce the weight for the structural loads that you derive from CFD analysis with the constraints as stress or stiffness or displacement, we can introduce many design variables and then the constraints. Like stacking, thickness constraints, other manufacturing constraints, or placement constraints, etc. All those things can be optimized. So this is one case study has been done for aeromorphology. Customer has reduced the weight of the composite wing spar using our simulation technology, OptiStack and HyperStudy. HyperStudy is one tool where you can do a DOE study for nearly 256 variables can be varied to give the optimized design. So in this case, they obtained 50% weight reduction for the more range and then the more payload. So various manufacturing simulations can also be done right from the beginning. We have tool called Inspire. So to assess the casting performance or feasibility of casting, if there are any problem in casting or doing the metal forming operations or extrusion or molding operation. Of course, the trend is nowadays additive manufacturing can also be right from the concept stage. You can do the simulations. This is one case study on metal printing, 3D printing. So So right from this, you take the structure, apply various loads and prepare the design and then simulate it. And then directly you can take it to the 3D printer. So this is an example where Aerosoft has used Altair inspired technology for achieving this drone design. So the major benefit was optimizing the way, reducing the weight at the concept level itself, getting the best topology, and then do the 3D printing, reduce the development time, material, and then the cost, of course, and reduce the waste. So these are the various simulation structural aspects of the product can be assessed. Now I hand over to Soundarya to cover up on the EM simulations.
Thank you, Vasant.
I stopped sharing. Yeah, Soundarya.
Kindly let me know if my voice is audible as well as if my screen is visible.
Yeah, visible, Soundarya. Yeah, thank it you. Is audible.
Thanks to everyone for joining the session today. So the next phase in the design cycle that we'll be talking about is on the connectivity front, especially more about the antenna designs as well as the placement of antennas onto the AV models, so on and so forth. And in addition to it, the ECU components, that is your control units, the PCB models when it is being placed, the design and verification of those particular components. Let's take a simple drone model into account. As you're aware of, there are multiple components that are put together in order to make a proper reliable connectivity as well as in order to make a better solution for it. So some of them being the telemetry antenna systems and some of them also being the receiver modules which are placed into the drone module itself. So in addition to it, there are also motor controls which are being present as well as some of the PCB models which are also being present. So that's where the trends and challenges comes into picture. So one of the most challenging options that is available in this case is regarding the antennas that are being present. So the antennas are required for a more reliable communications and mainly specifically talking about the non-line of sight conditions. So as you're aware, currently the urban environment is having so many number of obstacles. So if you want to fly your drone in a particular urban environment, the effect of those antenna systems is very much important to understand in that particular environment. And apart from this, the telemetry connection, that is your connection between your remote control modules and along with the receiver that is placed inside your drone systems. So the effect of these conversions or the connections between these components is also very much important, and it's very challenging in certain conditions. In addition to it, it is also known as radio coverage and connectivity analysis that is also being performed. And when it comes to the ECU control modules or the PCB modules which are being placed, the signal integrity and power integrity analysis is one of the most important analysis to be performed. Apart from this, there are also electrical root cause analysis, which can manifest into SIPI as well as EMI issues in the further design places. So how does these technology trends as well as challenges can be mitigated into a simulation environment? That's where the simulation tools comes into picture. Specifically talking about today's session is on the electronic system design framework. So mainly talking about certain components like motors, sensors, and actuators can be designed and as well as verified in a simulation environment to see the verification of those particular components itself. So some of the components that has been listed over here are the motors which are being present, as well as one of the component is a sensor, which is nothing but a coil sensor that is also being simulated in a simulation environment. The second part of a known radiating sources are the antennas. So the design of those antennas and evaluating the placement of those antennas onto your UAV or the drone models is one of the most important tasks. And in addition to this, the EMI EMC analysis, the RCS analysis, as well as bioelectromagnetic analysis can also be performed using the simulation tool FICO and NeoFasant. And once your component level settings are being done, so when it's time to deploy them into a real-time environment or a virtual environment in this case, so which is the wave propagation and radio network planning. So how does your antennas win along with your UAVs behave in a real-time environment? That's where WinProp and RAP comes into picture. And finally, the electronic control units, which is nothing but the PCB boards which are present inside, analyzing and verifying those PCB boards is performed by Polex. So let's go into the application front. So first application that we'll be talking about is the antenna design and placement of the particular system. So one of the most recent trends or one of the most common trends currently is the 5G connectivity system itself. So most of the employers actually are moving towards the 5G connectivity, specifically about the device integration as well as the base station integration. So when we talk about 5G, the major challenge in 5G is to reduce the antenna footprint and also higher amount of gain. So when you want a high amount of gain, we have to move towards high frequencies. So that's why in for 5G analysis, you'll see the frequencies of sub 6 gigahertz as well as highest frequencies of about 20 gigahertz or 26 gigahertz. So when you're designing at certain high frequencies, there is a high chance of coupling between the components that you're maintaining. Mainly because of this high gain requirements, you need an array model, which is what is being shown in this particular case, for a device system that is integrated onto a PCB module itself. And this is on the lower end, that is the device component itself. And when you're talking about the base station, it becomes much more larger, mainly again due to the higher gain requirements. So it requires a large number of arrays to be placed over in that particular setup. So the design process that is being shown in this particular scene is regarding a simple component design to a much more 16x16 array design over the period of using the simulation setup. And as you can see, as the number of elements in a particular array system increases, the gain as well as the radiation pattern of the setup also gets modified. The effect of these components can be analyzed easily in a simulation environment. And to make sure that your antennas are actually working efficiently, this process is very much needed. So that's about the antenna design part. So once you place it on the UAVs, there are actually effect of the UAVs on the antenna performance itself. In this particular case, there is a simple direction finding antenna, which is also the actual name of the antenna is actually a monocone antenna, which is a wireframe model. So usually these antennas are placed on the wings of the aircraft structures or UAV structures in this particular case. As you're seeing, we have just taken the wing of the UAV model and then the antenna design is being done and the antenna is being placed on the UAV model. By default, a monocone antenna of this particular sort is usually an omnidirectional antenna. That means it radiates equally in all directions. So that is also one of the parts that you're seeing over in this particular case. But the same antenna, when it is being mounted on a UAV structure or any kind of structure in this place, the effect of the material composition as well as the type of the structure that is being mounted on can cause the impact or changes on the antenna performance itself. So that's where you can see there are like some of the redefined nulls that are being present over here. So one of the major challenge in terms of antenna placement is to make sure that these nulls does not have an impact on your connectivity as well as the communication between the different components as the base station or as your UAV component itself. So this one such case is actually performed in FICO in the simulation environment, and it is measured in the actual real-time environment, and the values are actually compared in this visualization setup. The second case or the second most recent trend is regarding the converting smaller electrical structure of antenna systems itself. So this particular case, as you can see, the antennas are actually fixed on the UAV modules itself. It is much more like a conformal solution itself. So this can actually reduce a lot of requirements, basically like reducing the aerodynamic drag of having a protruding antenna on the surface. And it can also improve certain amount of performances over the system itself. So one of the performance that you can notice in this in the graphs is basically the equivalent coverage in all directions. So even though it shows only certain half of the directions, you can see it's much more equivalent coverage and the nulls are actually pretty much reduced. So this design of these type of antennas can be analyzed, or this design can be set up for different modal analysis by using the characteristic mode solutions that is available within FICO. So these are some of the different concepts or trends that is developing in the antenna design as well as the placement part of it. So these are all the known sources or the sources that the user is actually adding onto the system. What about the unknown sources? That's where the other challenges comes into picture. Specifically talking about HIRF, high intensity radiated fields. So this is nothing but an external radiation source which is so high which can impact the internal components that is present inside your UAVs or the drones. So this can also be compared with lightning strikes. Let's take a simple model in this particular case. As you can see, this is a simple UAV structure which is having a glass dome which is covering the camera module. And then the UAV is assigned with certain material composition over the structure. And it is also having two different cables which are running inside the UAV module. So as you are aware of, the components inside your modules are connected with multiple types of cables. So in this case, we have taken two cables. One is shielded and the other one is unshielded cables. And the external radiation source might be from any kind of radiation source. It might be a base station, it might be a radar antenna, so on and so forth. So that is being depicted in this case using a plane wave source, which is nothing but it is showing the impact, the angle of impact on the UAV system itself. Two different analyses is being done. So one is basically to understand the shielding effectiveness of a shielded versus an unshielded cable. And the second one is if the property of this glass dome is getting modified, how does it behave in this particular environment? So the results in this particular case shows the differences between the shielded and unshielded cable. We'll be coming back to that. Specifically, the different material compositions is what actually shows us a much more redefined setup. So the plexiglass in both the accounts of the shielded as well as the unshielded cables sends a lot of like the voltage is getting much more coupled into the cables itself. Whereas the aluminium, which is actually a metallic composite, so it should actually reflect all the rays together. So that's why you are seeing the aluminium on the bottom place. And then the carbon fiber composite. So this is one of the reasons why most of the people are actually moving towards carbon fiber composite or composite materials in the general sense. So one, it has a better shielding effectiveness. And second, it is also much more lightweight compared to the other equipments. So in this particular results, it is also very much visible that the carbon fiber composite is very much close to the aluminium, providing a good shielding for these particular components which are present inside the UAVs. And the second part, the shielded cables are much more effective than the unshielded cables, especially on the lower frequencies. So there is only one particular peak, which is at the quarter wavelength of the cable, which is expected. And the harmonics of these particular frequencies is also expected. So we know that there are certain cases where we need to be much more effective in the shielding. But whereas the unshielded is considered, most of the values, especially on the plexiglass, is above minus 20 dB. Of 20 dB ohms, which is being present. This is not good in terms of protecting your components that is present inside your UAV modules. So this analysis can very much help in understanding what type of shielding to be present, what type of materials to be allocated for different UAV modules. And just to give a little more brief about, so this is the same composite module with a much more wider frequency range. As I mentioned earlier, the harmonics of the different frequencies have different peaks, whereas the rest of the components, when it is shielded, it is much more, very much less in terms of the voltage levels that is getting absorbed into the cable systems itself. So that is on the antenna design or the external sources as well as the internal sources that is being present. How does it all come together in a simulation environment is when we are combining different tools together. So specifically talking about the first part, which is nothing but the design as well as the analysis of the different antenna systems on the drone modules using FICO. As you can see, the first part itself is just your generic antenna modules, designing them individually, analyzing them in free space and getting the characteristics of those antenna systems. So this can be either you can use a CAD model or you can also use a generic measured model also in this particular case. Then placement of these antenna systems onto the drones and analyzing the effect of those antenna modules and the variation in the radiation pattern of this particular case is also analyzed using FICO. So that's where the component level comes into picture. So the next part is where the system level design comes into account. That is, how does your antenna behave in a real-time environment? How does it behave when there is an obstacle being present? That's where larger environment comes into account. That's been done using the WinProp solution or the simulation environment in WinProp. So as you can see, this is a drone module which has been analyzed in FICO and it is being brought back into WinProp. And the rest of the urban environment is also being taken into WinProp account. There is a base station which is present at one particular point. This base station is in communication with the antenna that is mounted on the drone system itself. The colored path actually depicts the flight path of this particular drone. And the colors represent the different power levels that is attributed or the connection between the drone and the base station that is also being present. One other advantage of doing this analysis or doing a simulation environment for this particular case is we can understand how the multipath effects takes place. So as you can see, these blue lines are nothing but the when there is a non-line of sight condition, that is your drone cannot directly communicate with your base station, it goes into multipath condition. So this shows the different paths and this can help in understanding what would be the latency time between your base station and then the antenna that is present on the drone. This helps in effective connectivity as well as in effective communication between the components that is present on the equipment itself. So the next part is actually a different UAV module, which is also being present, an antenna system, which is analyzed using FICO. And as you can see, this is a radiation setup that is being taken into account. So as I mentioned earlier, rural environment has a lot of number of obstacles in terms of buildings and so on and so forth. Whereas in urban environment, you have the obstacles in a different form, that is a dense forest and so on and so forth. So that's why you're seeing the topographical region that is being taken into account. And this is a hilly region. Once the antenna is out of sight, that is out of the line of sight, so you can see the power level is actually very much reduced. So this can help in determining the flight path of your particular drone modules, as well as to see how reliable the communication is between your receiver as well as the transmitter modules in the systems itself. So you can also depict 3D trajectories as well as different aircraft orientations to see a better communication between the systems. So these are all the additional sources or external sources that is being added into the system. So apart from that, there are other radiation sources that is also present in your modules, which are nothing but the ECU components, which is the PCB setup. So verifying and optimizing these PCBs are very much important in order to understand the reliability of those condition systems itself. So specifically, when we talk about the PCB solution analysis, Pollex EDA actually presents a very much possible solution setup in order to review, analyze, verify, as well as extract these solution sets over the PCB solution itself. Specifically, due to the development of high speed as well as high frequency and low voltage electronic equipments, there is a high concern regarding the various noises that can be depicted over these components that is being emitted into the system. Initially, these noises were not much of importance, but recently it can cause certain amount of impact in terms of the overall issues that is causing into the system itself. So in order to reduce the PCB design iterations, it is essential to ensure the behavior reliability, like signal and power integrity analysis, which can be performed in a simulation environment, and also a thermal distribution analysis in order to understand how the PCB components are reacting for different equipment setups. So Altair offers a Pollex suite, which actually helps in verifying all these component solutions as well as different solving solutions. And it is also integrated with different ECAD native formats, which can help in better reliable connectivity or transference of data from one tool to another. Specifically, when we talk about the applications or the major issues in terms of PCB analysis, so the signal and power integrity analysis has become a very much important, mainly to understand or to reduce the turnaround time that is present to the market. So to optimize the PCB interconnects, we can actually perform the time and frequency domain analysis. And along with it, the pre and the post layout analysis can also be performed using the PCB module systems. In addition to this, these analyses can help in understanding the issues such as reflections, overshoot, undershoot, crosstalk, and as well as the overall understanding of the PCB interconnect systems which are being present. And in order to optimize the split power planes over different components that is being present on the PCB, it is essential to perform the DC IO drop analysis. The number, value, placement, and routing style of the decoupling caps can also be optimized by performing a PDN analysis, which is nothing but a power distribution network analysis. So this is the overall components in terms of electronic system design toolkit. And in order to show you how it can be put together in a single format, there's a short video that is being played.
Yeah, we can't hear the sound.
Sorry, I think there is some issue. One of the first things that we talked about is regarding the smart product development to understand the electrical differences that is happening on the product itself. So these are the components that can be analyzed, especially on the assembly part. How does the different components work on different electrical checks as well as manufacturability checks to make sure that you have a reliable PCB interconnect that is being performed. So this is what my colleague earlier was talking about regarding the full system performance. So once your individual components are being tested out, it can also be taken into a larger scope of environment. The effect of actuators and different motor controls, which are also being present, can be analyzed in this particular case in order to improve the efficiency of those components and as well as improve the connectivity of those components. That's the conclusion of electronic system design toolset. Coming up next, my colleague, Mr. Srinivas Thangudu, will be talking about the latest trends in IoT and as well as digital twin platform. Thank you.
Thanks, Sandhya. So everybody can see my screen?
Yeah, Srinivas, yes.
Okay. So great. So today, I will talk about like how a smart product development can be done for the UAVs using the Altair Digital Platform. So to start with, like if you are in this session and you are looking, you want to build some smart connected products, these are one of the motivations for you to build these smart products. Either you want to build a extend user functionality so that users can take control of your product anywhere in the world and they can use your a front-end dashboards nicely so that they can use this as an application, as a mobile application, so that they can take the benefit of your product. Or it can be like your business model. You want to give your product as a service and you want to reduce, because when you are building this as a service model, you are taking the complete product responsibility and you want to reduce that risk. So you want to continuously monitor your asset. Or it can be want to build a streamlining process where you want to make sure that you're continuously monitoring your asset and you want to make sure that your UAV is continuous running efficiently and it is highly available and it is cheap maintenance. Like that should not be heavy cost of maintenance. So it should not be reactive maintenance. You should immediately, if you find an anomalies, you can take the action. So to build this any smart product, so we are talking about, in the previous sessions, you have already explored how you can design a product and you can do a product engineering using your multiphysics simulation platform. So now we are talking about smart product. So when you are talking about smart product, these are the complex things adds up like embedded development, software development or DevOps, or you want to continuously improvement using machine learning models deployment. So all these things needs a lot of effort, it needs a lot of resources, and it is more riskier. Like if you are using some open source platform, tomorrow if you are not able to, you are now building a small prototype application, but tomorrow when you want to production grade application, you want to deploy, it will not be scalable. So it is suggestible that always use a COTS platform where you can get continuous support and the platform, it will take care of that, whatever the new trends of technology is coming. So it is like whenever we say that smart product development is always like iceberg. So we think that whatever the front end we are seeing, the nice application as a web application we are seeing, that is the front end, which is like hardly takes 20% of the total effort. But the real effort is taken in the backend, which is the 80% as you see in the submerged this iceberg. So the backend development, DevOps development, edge orchestration, all these things, it should be highly scalable, highly available, and it should be a containerized platform so that tomorrow you want to build based on your business logic, you want to build some backend applications, you can immediately bring that as a microservice and integrate with the platform. So this, I will take you through a small video to what it can be done. I hope you are able to hear the audio.
Yes, we can able to hear your audio.
But thanks. Not the video's audio that are asking.
Video audio, you are not able to hear?
No.
Okay. So what I mean, you're currently UAV is the current asset. And then you want to build a front end where like you, which will be exposed to your end users. Then you have to build a back end, which is deployed on an edge application because your drone is an edge application where you want to deploy. So all these things like very complex and very costly if you are not properly take care of the platform in the beginning of the, I mean, your development phase. And you want, so this Altair SmartWorks platform will help you to take care of all this, like your backend development, your database perspective, any database you can use for the time series DB or a metadata storage perspective, any SQL or non-SQL DB. And edge perspective. So when you are talking about edge, it is like you can use this as a platform for edge development, and you can use this development for backend development. When you're talking about the backend, it is asset connectivity and modeling, specialized telemetry and metadata databases. It supports serverless functions as an engine. You can drag and drop, and you can do real-time streaming. Fine-grained role-based access control because it is highly required, and high-performance REST APIs because the communication should be very fast. Let's suppose there is a collision is happening, you cannot wait. It should immediately detect and send the alert. And the front-end, you can use the drag-and-drop functionality of a web application to build your nice dashboards, and you can build a web app. As the platform itself will provide you like mobile application as well as web application. And last but not the least, when you want to scale it, the security perspective also, all the tech challenges will be taken care of with the platform itself. So that means from a prototype to when you go for a production grade application development, you can leverage this. Now we'll talk about like what are the different components required for a SmartWorks application. When you talk about this value chain of the smart product development, it starts from data ingestion to till the final live application development. So it needs, you are planning to give a complete unified platform where everything you can do it in one platform. You need not to depend on multiple vendors or multiple open source softwares or platforms. So you can do it the same platform. You can use data ingestion, you can use for data preparation, you can use for data discovery and real-time data visualization. You can use for your data science or model building, and you can use same platform as the IoT platform for edge ops and edge orchestration. Same platform you can use for prescriptive modeling or digital twin modeling. Then you can use, our high performance computing, like if you have a heavy computing is there, how you can leverage CPUs or GPUs in the same platform. And not what the least finally is that how you can build a model factory where machine learning models you can deploy as an RBM challenger model, and you can do continuous intelligence systems, you can build it. So when you talk about a platform, it requires all these capabilities. It should be highly secured and highly scalable. It should have roles and access control. It should have scheduling and notifications. And as it is an unmanned vehicle, so it requires like continuous logging and monitoring. So if there is any issue is there that from the user, you can real time monitor it, and you can looking at the log, you can understand what is the issue. And multiple, when you are talking about a smart product development, these are the different personas will take play, to build this application. So same platform will be used by all this, like data engineer maybe use, no need to use in a separate platform. And your data scientist may not use, not required to use this different platform. So everybody, all the personas can use the same platform. So the whole complete ML pipeline from the data ingestion to till the live system, you can use with the same one digital platform, unified digital platform. And this digital platform is cloud agnostic. So most of UAV startups are working on the leveraging the cloud benefit. So they can, if whatever the cloud you're using, you can take benefit of that cloud. It can be deployable any cloud. And if you tomorrow, like a cost perspective, if you want to migrate into on-premises, so it is not like you have to again develop from scratch. You can take the same application and migrate it to on-premises in the future. So to talk about like how these you can say wherever that Orange Altair logo is there, these are all Altair platforms for each stage. Means for data preparation, Monarch will be used, data visualization, Panopticon real time and Panopticon BI will be used for data science, SmartWorks analytics, Knowledge Studio will be used. But all these are interconnected and interlinked. So you can use one platform with the which will give you can leverage all these applications. And it doesn't restrict you that if you want to take benefit for building some business application with your open source, like let's suppose you want to handle a big data source and you want to connect some Hadoop tables or a Scala or Impala tables, you can, Knowledge Studio supports in the backend Apache Spark. So you can do a big data processing as well as machine learning model training. You can do it. Let's suppose you want to explore what some models already supervised and unsupervised deep learning models already there in Knowledge Studio. You want to explore by yourself by writing your own model using a Python or R code. You can write in a Jupyter Hub and you can integrate it. Knowledge Studio is tight integration with Jupyter Hub. So because all the machine learning models are now commodity, every day new models are coming. So it doesn't restrict you that you can use only the models which are available in the Knowledge Studio. So in short, what means we are trying to do is that connect your data to your people using a simple single unified course platform, where you can do from all the, you can see like data pipe, building a data pipeline to machine learning model building deployment, till end, everything you can do. And wherever you want to take benefit of the, augment your process with the open sources, you can take benefit of those open sources, which are tightly linked with this platform. So you can, you need to explore again separately Apache Spark, or you don't need to separately explore MLflow. Everything is integrated in the same platform. So I will talk about one use case, how you can take benefit of digital twin. So digital twin, most of you might know, digital twin is nothing but creating a digital replica of your physical asset. And in the real time, you take the operational data from your physical asset and pass on to your digital replica and simulate it. And you build a recommendation system or you send the prescriptions based on if any anomalies or if you find any issues in the system, so you can build completely closed loop systems. So when you talk about digital twin, it comes to data twin as well as simulation twins, or which is called physics-driven twin. So in a when you do a real-time asset monitoring or predictive modeling setup, you connect your physical asset, stream the data from there real-time and process the data. And you can build, you store the historical data into some time series DB, and with that build some anomaly detection or predictive models. And you continuously monitor your system. So what you can do is that once you have data-driven model is done, now you find that some anomalies are there, you can send the real-time data into your physics-based system. So this physics functional mockup already you have developed during your design phase only. So you need not to build again. So you can pass the physics real-time data, physical data to your physics-based simulation model. And you can do analysis or a recommendation system, so you can build, which will send you the prescription to the physical asset. So if you are building a completely closed loop automation control, then the prescription will go and take care of the physical asset. Or if you are building a semi-automatic, you can send the triggers or alerts to the ground station engineer, what action to be taken, and he can take the control, and he can control the using HMI, human machine interface, he can control that physical asset. So give you one scenario, this is the physical asset which is a drone is running on the field, and you take the operational data from there. And you have a take after the processing and you store into a historical database and you build some data models using our Knowledge Studio or a data science platform. Then this can be a predictive model or a classification model, or it can be an anomaly detection model. So whenever you find some anomaly, you want to understand what is the root cause of that anomaly. So you send that immediate, the real-time data at that instance to a digital, your simulation model, physics-based simulation model. So here it is a CFD simulation model. And you do the root cause analysis using this simulation model and send the recommendations to the physical asset. So this completes your data-driven modeling or physics-driven modeling, that whole digital twin platform. So when you are talking about digital twin platform, it needs a lot of things. applications. It should support, it needs a IoT platform where you directly stream the data from the real-time asset. Then you need a data analytics system where you can do the feature engineering, you can do the data processing in a real time. And once you have processed data stored into a database, you can, historical data is there, you can build a machine learning model. And the once you have built the your prediction system tells, anomaly is there, you can pass that data to a simulation model. The simulation model can be a 3D physics model, or it can be a reduced order model, or it can be a co-simulation model. So this simulation will give you a prescription. So when you connect these two things, the real-time asset and your digital replica, and you real-time, you do the data connectivity, processing, and modeling all together simultaneously, the digital platform works seamlessly. So this digital platform can be anything. When you are doing the product design to improve your product, you can use it. Or you are want to build some real-time asset monitoring, or you want to build some predictive maintenance kind of you want, whenever some anomaly is there, what can be action can be taken. So depending on the business case, you can build your digital twin. So let me end up this slide. This is the last slide. So here, what I'm trying to do is that using this platform, you can do all this because these are the, each thing is required for a smart product. When you say smart product development, and this is like edge orchestration, you can do with SmartWorks IoT, you can do edge jobs with SmartWorks IoT, you want to do data preparation with Monarch, you can do data modeling and machine learning model preparation with Knowledge Studio, you can deploy the models and create a model factory with Alta SmartWorks Analytics, and you want to build some controllers, electronics, you can use Alta Compose, Activate, Embed. So all these things are covered in the previous session. Then you can build a DevOps, you want to build some backend system business logics using Alta SmartWorks IoT. And finally, the real-time data streaming and visualization platform is used. You can explore the Alta Panoptica. But all these things are interlinked in single digital platform. So for you, some good news is there, if you want to really explore digital platform, the SmartWorks IoT is already deployed on Azure Cloud. So this is the link, swx.altair1.com. You can go there and you can register yourself. And then you can explore and you can port your whatever the use case you have built with your open source platform, and you can explore the SmartWorks platform. And if you need any technical queries, or you want to some training material or something, you can connect us. We can pass on the information based on your business. So with this, I would like to end my session. Thank you.
Thank you, Srinivas. Yeah, Deep, is it from Altair? Now we are open to take questions. Sushil?
Yes, Vasanta.
Yeah.
I see that there were quite a number of questions in the chat window that most of us have answered. But to kind of summarize our presentation here, what I would like to say is that very well probably know that there is a lot which goes into the drone, right? There is so much of complexity in a drone, the kind of physics involved in a drone and how they all come together to interact with each other, the different physics. So what you would typically need is a platform or a framework which can tie all these physics together so that you can design and develop a drone the right way. And we at Altair provide you that kind of platform, which gives you right from the initial concept stage, all the toolkits and the technology, which will help us to design and develop a drone the right way. And additionally, at the end, as Srinivas mentioned, it can also help you to deploy a drone for your application, whatever application that you're designing for. So all the IoT, which is required, the Internet of Things, as well as the digital twin, which helps us to deploy the drone for a particular application, is what we have in this entire framework. So I think with that quick summary, I think we can open up for any questions, Deep.
Sushil, I think we can open up the audio also if anybody wants to ask any questions.
Deep can help, yeah.
I think participants can ask. Am I audible? I'm a participant.
Yes, participants can ask. If someone wants to raise their hand, I'll just call them.
Okay.
Hello.
Suraj, you can go ahead, please.
Okay, cool. So, hi. So, I have a few questions. One is regarding the simulation. So can we input any environmental parameters like air, altitude, temperature, humidity? And the second one is the current draw from motors. Like I haven't seen that point, if I'm not wrong. Third one is the vibration analysis. FEA and CFD, I think you guys have showed that. So can you like talk about these three things? Thanks.
Okay. So I think there are multiple parts to your question. For each of those questions, probably the subject matter experts can answer questions.
Yeah, Sushil, let me answer the CFD and environmental factors. So yeah, we can take up the environmental and the altitude. If you know the pressure at what altitude, if you know the mission, if at what angle air cuts through the system, in this case a drone, the pressure and at what velocity, all this can be imposed, and then effect on the structure, both from the flow point of view as well as the structural point of view, can be studied. And I think your third question is on the vibrations. Vibration part, with various modes or various configurations, can be analyzed. I don't remember the second question. Sorry.
Vasant, I remember the second question. I think it was on the motor current drawn, I guess, if I'm not wrong. So, yes, that is pretty much possible. Probably not extensively mentioned in the slides, but yes, once you have a system model built, you could pretty much get the results in terms of the values, whatever are getting drawn from motors. Basically, in terms of current drawn or even the demand that is required by the battery and so on, all those informations can be extracted.
Okay, thank you. And a little some more information on the vibration analysis. Are we supposed to input them manually, or can it be a function of the motor's RPM? I mean, that's the
I got your point. See, vibration, there are you can do free vibrations, and then you can do forced vibrations. And if you have the motor RPM or the motor map curve, and then their PST functions or the vibration function from not only from motor or any other vibrating member. So you can apply that onto the structure, and you can study the vibrations.
Okay, thank you so much. And this is great, actually.
Thanks for that, yeah. I see that Tanmay has some questions.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, sir. So my question is very basic. In case we want to learn all the simulation and all the things you we talked about today, is there any kind of tutorial available on your website or on your university? that we're talking about?
Yeah, yes, of course. You can visit Altair University website. You'll get all the details, videos, study material, webinars, all those you'll have access. But you have to be a student, to access it.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Specifically for quads also.
Quads mean?
Quadcopters.
Sure. Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
So, any more questions?
I don't see anyone raising their hands. So, Vasant or Ajay, if you could conclude, that would be ideal.
Yeah, Ajay, over to you.
So, anybody, I would like to know, anybody is here, trying to explore our SmartWorks platform for building a IoT framework or the DevOps smart product development. As I was talking, showing the slide in the end of my presentation. So if anybody is interested, just so they can directly log in into the swx.altair1.com and log in by themselves and explore that. If you have any challenge, let us know.
Thanks, Srinivas. Let me take a lead. Thank you all for participation. Trust that you are excited and having learned the different aspects of simulation, product development, design and development of drones, how simulation tools could be used for product design. So for any further information, or you want to have any details about how to go about and what are the tools that can be used for any particular physics, etc., you can contact us through Deep, or I think Deep, they'll have access to Altair through DFI.
Definitely, I think if you can share someone from your team's email also in the chat box, so that people can write to you directly as well.
Sushil, you can put that in some email, customer support or...
Yeah. I'll just put that in the chat window.
Maybe marketing@altair.com.
That's what I was just putting. I just put the marketing email ID. You can write to that.
Ardeep, if somebody directly sends you a mail, you can forward it to us.
Yeah, definitely.
Me, Ajay, yeah. Thanks. That's all from our end, Deep.
Sure. Thank you so much for this webinar. I think a lot of people have learned a lot of stuff regarding how they can use simulation practices. So we'll wait for everyone to just exit, and if there are any things in the chat box, I'll just let you know. All right. Thank you.